Good afternoon, everybody. This is Jakob Heilmann Clausen speaking here from the University of Copenhagen, presenting some highlights from the Danish Fungal Atlas. I'm really happy to be here, even though it's in online format, but it's a nice session and I'm happy to participate, and thanks for the invitation to the organizers. So the Danish Fungal Atlas originally started in 2009, but building on an older internet recording platform for fungal records made in Denmark. It was a five-year project running with two full-time positions per year, but distributed over five professional mycologists. The project was started by Jan Westerholt, who some of you have met in the past. He unfortunately died during the project, after only 2 years. That was a big loss for Danish mycology and mycology in general, but he got this idea to start this fungal project and also got the funding to it. And it has really, so it has provided some input that is still really making a difference for mycology in Denmark. The main purpose of the original project was basically to increase knowledge and awareness of macrofungi in the society, and of course with a specific fungus on nature conservation. So the foundation, the Ove Jensen Foundation that paid us, was really keen that the information we collected should be made available for nature managers taking more care of macrofungi than they normally do. And I think we have succeeded in that. After the first project phase, we realized that we built a success. There was a lot of interest in the project, and we were lucky enough to get funding for five more years, which involved the rebuild of the whole database structure and user interface involving Thomas Dianegaard Jeppesen and Tobias Frøslev. Thomas was the computer guru that actually built our new portal. We also had to make a book about the experiences we got from the first project phase, and provide identification keys. It's a project we are still working on. It's coming out next year. And there's also some other aspects, including the development of native app for mobile phones. And there's not any specific goals in the project, but I think unofficially we wanted to make Denmark the hotspot of fungal recording on the globe. And based on these figures from GBIF, it seems that we more or less succeeded in that. When you zoom in on Denmark, you can see that Schizophyllum commune, which is more or less globally distributed, has the most intensive recording in the Copenhagen area in Denmark and the globe. So we have really got a lot of fungal records going on in Denmark. The database is built up on a taxon database that stores all the information of species in Denmark, including photos and distribution to specific morpho groups and ecological roles, Danish names, and so on. And of course, a user database that stores our users. And if you combine that with a date and a place in Denmark, we have a record. And to these records, we add information about the habitat, substrate. There's a lot of photos associated with the record and so on. And the taxon database builds an index fungorum, so we import our species names from that source to keep connected to the global society of taxonomists. And we share our own database with GBIF on a weekly basis, and the same is the case for the record, so everything is available globally all the time and for research and nature management. For the users, we have different resources. There's resources for IDing, I'm coming back to those. And then we have recording pages, and we have species presentation pages, and several other special features that users can go in and look at. The validation of records is built on a rather sophisticated interactive system. It's made so that all users can vote for existing species IDs, and they can also add new species IDs. So here we have a rather boring quaternary species where you have three different IDs competing. You can see that they have different weights here. Normally, well, not normally, but the concept is if the score reaches 74, it's approved as a validated record. You can see here, I'm an expert, so I'm able actually to downvote the records also. I can see I have voted for this determination. But for normal users, it's only possible to upvote records. You cannot give a negative vote. That's in order to keep a good and constructive environment among our users. But the validation can happen by two different processes. An expert, and we are around 10 of those, can make the final decision and say this is exactly that species, or it can be done based on interactive interactions between our users combined with smart filters. And these smart filters are taxon specific based on the rarity of each species, its geographical distribution and the phenology. So you need to, if you want to have, well, a record of a rare species in a region where it's never been recorded in the wrong time of the year is much more unlikely to be approved compared to a record of a common species occurring in the exact right season in a known area. The weights are then also user specific. So if you have a lot of experience with bolides and a lot of approved records, you will have a higher weight. And it's also on the species specific level. If you have many records of one species, it helps you to have a higher saying in the voting process. And more than 3/4 of our records are validated in the community. Some are expert validated. And we also allow validation at a higher than species level, for instance, at the genus level or just as a fungus SP. So that's why we have such a high number of actually validated record, because we can say we don't know exactly what it is. To give some training to our users and build the community, we have annual recording camps. In the first phase of the project, we had 2 annual recording camps. And then we have a lot of dialogue in the microforum with our users. So here's one example of a microforum related to this quaternary species. And you can see that it's also possible to pin people to take a check on specific records and add their information to it. And that helps really in having a good society. It's an extremely helpful resource. Then we have identification keys. First, we used quite a bit the MicroKey that some of you may know. We also are working on these dichotomic keys that is more traditional but well illustrated. So that's what we are going to print in a book, hopefully in 1 year's time. And then since 2019, we have species recognition based on artificial intelligence, which is available on this page or in our mobile app, the Svampe Atlas app, that is free to download for all sorts of smartphones, and it's basically built by Czech computer scientists. You can read more about the details in this paper. It's trained on around 85,000 images from our database and is able to identify around 1,400 species with, according to our testing, around 85% security. So it's actually pretty amazing what it can do compared to the challenges involved with species identification. During the time where we have been running this project, the number of users and recordings have changed quite a bit. In the early phase, there was not that many users, only around 100 really dedicated people. With the launch of the Fungal Atlas, that rose to around 200 users per year. It was the same in the beginning of the Fungal Atlas 2.0. The launch of the interactive validation processes increased the number of users quite a bit, but it was really the native app with this AI identification tool that really boosted our number of users to more than 1,000 per year. And that's helping us to have more and more records of fungi per year. Now we are reaching around 80,000 last year, and maybe even more in 2021. But it also, especially the native app for the mobile phone, really changed the recording profile. So we have many more users that are not giving a lot of records, but just a few. So we are really changing from a small number of highly dedicated users that really know the system and are active in the validation process to many more users that are more loosely associated with the product. And that's a challenge because we have a lot of people that don't really play after the rules and where we have to use a lot of energy to try to learn them how to do things. So this success that we have with the native app is also a challenge. Very recently, we started sequencing quite a lot of our collections, starting in 4 years ago with Sanger sequencing. So far, we have run around 400 collections based on that platform. And that has provided relatively interesting results. More than 300 had a very good match, some were uncertain, and could also identify around 10 new species to science. We don't have described those yet. Some are being worked on by other people. For those with a good match, you can see that most represent well-known Danish taxa, but there's also quite a number of new records. So more than 100 new species could actually be approved as Danish or confirmed as new Danish species based on this sequencing approach. And from last year, we also started testing a high throughput pipeline where we can now cut down the cost of sequencing to a minimum. And we are just now preparing more than 1,000 collections for sequencing to really boost knowledge about Danish biodiversity. But just based on the first Sanger sequencing approach, we could, for instance, with a genus like Hydenum, really improve our knowledge a lot about what's going on in Denmark. Usually we accepted three species, white, yellowish, and cream colored. And we also know that this more cream to orange colored was basically three different species, Umbilicatum in the European sense, and Ellipsosporum was also proven before we had the ITS. But with these new tools, we could add four new species to the list. And actually a fifth was added this year. So we now have 10 species compared to three species in the old days. So this is just one example. It's even more crazy what's going on in general, like Cortinirus and Inosibie. We have published some papers about the project. One a standalone paper is describing how the project has improved knowledge about macrofungi in Denmark. Where we can see that the number of known species is actually just increasing over time. It's not leveling out yet. And this is mainly related to improved taxonomic knowledge and a clear effect of more search. So we even had species described as new to science based on our recordings, and in this case also a type specimen collected in Russia. So we can show with this project that citizen scientists can really boost knowledge about biodiversity in one of the most well-explored and most cultivated countries in the world. The data is used a lot in Denmark for nature conservation, both in the high nature value map, where you can see different areas with different colors, depending on how many threatened species they support. But also for systematic conservation planning as the designation of new nature reserves based on complementarity in species composition, not only built on fungi, but including fungal records to quite a high degree. We have also made standalone research, including 10 research papers that are fully or partly based on the data. And when we look at GBIF, you can see that there's more than 80 citations of the data set. So it's used a lot. So this was just a very quick travel through the Danish Fungal Atlas. I'm happy to answer any questions over the app or later on by email if you should be interested in more. So thank you for the attention and hope to see you in reality in the physical world sometimes in the future. Bye-bye.